a series of events that have to happen in terms of building up to creating a sculpture. So you have to make an armature, which is the structural aspect of it that you can then build or clay or plasticine or wax or whatever medium you want to model your original sculpture. I usually use plasticine or wax. And so that looks very short here, but it's actually only a couple of months' work, depending on what has been made and how big it is or small it is or whatever. Once that is completed, then you can send it to the foundry, and they will take a silicone rubber mold from that. And the silicone rubber is it comes in a liquid form, and you add a catalyst to it, and when it sets, it becomes all rubbery. And usually when more about that, yes. The thickness around our sculpture, you can see I'm just sort of dribbling it on there. And then a plastic cap is put on the outside of that, and that will hold the flexible silicone in place. You can see I'm just taking the plastic cap off here and see, I don't know if you can see it. the rubber coming off the main sculpture. That sculpture then can actually be reused. And the silicone in the mold is actually the most important part of it now. This aspect of it is now no longer needed. And the mold is then taken by the foundry. They put some molten wax into it, either paint it or pour it until it's about that thick. And all bronzes are only about that thick. Even those really big ones that you see, unless it's very small. And there's many reasons for that. One of them is if the bronze cools from the in, you know, the outside quicker than the inside, and you end up with something sort of pulling and all sorts of things. So a very good bronze is consistently thick throughout. That way it will cool and be consistent within the process. And that'll make a good bronze. Once you've painted the wax in it, it's quite a hard wax, and you can now pull the rubber mold off and fix up the wax, just check there's no air bubbles, or you get seam lines, and you've got to fickle those down until you have the sculpture. And then onto that sculpture, they put runners and risers, they wax initially, and it's called gating this part. And this is where you allow the pouring cup, the air vents. So when you're doing the pouring, it's all in preparation for later. So once you've finished gating, it now starts the second mold. This is the waste mold. And they put a ceramic shell onto that, about that thick, dipped into sand and zircon sand and slurry. And they build it up until it looks kind of quirky like that. That is then heated up. And the wax is lost. And so you end up with you can actually see the hollow space, which essentially was your wax sculpture. Okay. They then take that heated up mold, turn it up the other way around, and pour the molten bronze into that. Okay, so that's why they call it the lost wax. You lose the wax, and where the wax was, you pour the bronze in. And then you knock the when that's cooled, you knock the ceramic shell off and sandblast it, and you cut off all the runners and risers and the pouring cup, and you end up sandblasting it so it's got quite a sort of a bland metal sort of colour to it. And some pieces have to be welded together, and sometimes in the casting process it's better if the fireman cuts things off in the wax. And then when it's bronze, he welds them back together again. That way he can make sure he gets his detail.
And then that's the job of the foundry man?
The foundry staff, okay. Yeah. And then he's got about 12 staff that have different jobs. There's four ladies that do the waxes and the mold making, and their skill is specific in that direction. And then the other staff, some of them do dippings. Others chip out, and others, the whole staff get together and do the pouring, all the men. And then others do the chipping off and the cutting. And then Kim usually does all the welding, puts everything back together again, you can see the welding there. And then lastly, there's the patination. I usually do my own patination. and basically use different chemicals like ferric nitrate or cupric something or another and liver sulfur. And from these three chemicals, which are basically a crystal to dissolve in water, and then take a brush, heat up the bronze with a torch, with a gas torch, and then kind of etch the chemicals into it. So it makes a sizzling sound, kind of etches it. It's almost like a speeding up of the rusting process, like copper will grow green naturally in certain environments. We're kind of putting the chemical onto it, but the natural environment will eventually corrode the copper or bronze to depend on, I suppose, what's in the atmosphere. And so it's sort of like forcing that process. And then once you get the colour you want, you then seal it with wax.
Seal it with wax?
With wax, yes. And then it doesn't change too much after that. And you can just keep putting a wax on the sculpture to sort of preserve it.
So it does need to be maintained.
My sculptures are quite textured, and I find the only way to really get out that the dust that gathers in there is using like a liquid wax, like a wood ox or something like that, and then it sort of sinks and cleans out the dust and re-buffs up the sculpture. So I maintain it. Otherwise, you want to just give them a good buffeting, and you get back that sort of luster that they have. And I mean, all the different foundries have different skills. There's no one way of doing this, I suppose. And part of the joy of doing sculpture and bronze is the knowledge that there's so many things that one can experiment with and play with.
Okay, thank you.